Fellow Nigerians, our country is going through one of its worst moments in history. The state of Nigeria requires all of us, regardless of where we are on earth, to come out of our comfort zones to battle for our soul. Our country is under siege on all fronts. Our country has been taken over by janjaweeds that pretend to be leaders. The question is, how much can we take? How much more can we take? Here is a country where a citizen went into the hallowed chamber of the Senate and carted away the mace, the symbol.
Hey, fellow Nigerians, this is Smart Madu Ajaja, the anchor of Nigeria Now on ONN and then the Nightingale Radio International, broadcasting live from Houston, Texas, United States of America. Sorry, I had a professional emergency that I needed to address before I came to the studio. So that was the reason we're late. But we are out and ready to
As prepare. A northerner living in the south, facing mental torture, receiving abuses, insults, days after days, throwing shade of names like Aboki and Malam, while in essence Aboki means a friend or a brother and Malam means a teacher. I've always gotten myself rolling in tears, living like a prisoner and always questioning whether this is my country or not, whether this is my Nigeria that I was born and raised into. And why, as a southerner living in the north, equally facing stereotypes and being called names like Agbero, Inyamuri, Arne, facing daily difficulties and hatred in my own country. I was born with dignity and deserved to be treated like a human, especially in my own country. I call on my southern brothers and sisters to do away with the stereotypes and accept me as one of their own. Equally, I call on my northern brothers and sisters to draw away all the negative impressions they have on the south and treat me like their own kin. Let us come together and ensure the labor of our heroes past are not in vain. Let us come together and serve our country with heart and might. One nation bond in freedom, peace and unity. United we stand.
Free now, I've got to have my freedom. Time has come to stand up for Nigeria.
Stand up.
Time has come to stand up for Nigeria.
Stand up for Nigeria. Stand up. Stand up for Nigeria. When you look out, tell me what you see. You see the people suffering. When you look around, tell me what you see. You see the people wandering. The rich getting richer and the poor getting poorer. Killing and kidnapping. Too much corruption and inflation in our generation. Darkness and wickedness and unrighteousness. Where are we going to? Stand up for Nigeria. Stop killing one another. Stop fighting one another. We are one Nigeria. Open Nigeria. Wake up Nigeria. We are one Nigeria. Open your mind. Open your eyes. Please don't set your vote. Vote what is right. Vote for the light. Don't set your vote. Stand up.
Come on, let me sing again.
Open Nigeria. Stand up. Stand up for Nigeria.
We need free education and free medication. Equal right and justice. No more poverty, insecurity, terrorism and nepotism. Open Nigeria, wake up Nigeria. We are one people. Stop killing one another, stop fighting one another. We are one people. Stand up Nigeria, wake up Nigeria. Please don't say your vote. Stand up. Stand up for Nigeria.
Don't follow me, sing.
Stand up. Stand up for Nigeria.
Stand up.
Yes, stand up for Nigeria. Are you ready to stand up for Nigeria? The moment of which all of us must stand up for Nigeria is here. Our country is challenged on all fronts. So how would you want to be counted? How would you want to be remembered? When? Where do you want to be put in this struggle for the emancipation of Nigeria, for putting, you know, what is so compelling now that we must put the country on the path to genuine nationhood and greatness that will benefit all of us without exception. Yeah, today we are going to be talking to Kenneth Gbandi, a German-based Nigerian who is running for the coveted senatorial seat for Delta North Senatorial District in Delta State of Nigeria. He's going to be our guest today. Kenneth, I hope you are ready. Let us get this whole thing started. I am here. You know, again, I apologize for the delay in the start of this program. And, you know, I'm a professional medical personnel. I'm a nurse. And something just cropped up while I was about to get out, but I had to stay and resolve that matter. So I'm happy how it was resolved. And now we are ready to roll for Nigeria. Where's Kenneth Gbandi? We are waiting for you. It's important that you show up for duty.
And one day, some great opportunity stands before you and calls upon you to stand up for some great principle, some great issue, some great cause. And you refuse to do it because you are afraid. You refuse to do it because you want to live longer. You are afraid that you will lose your job, or you are afraid that you will be criticized, or that you will lose your popularity. Are you afraid that somebody will stab you or shoot at you or bomb your house?
Yes.
And so you refuse to take the stand. Well, you may go on and live until you are 90. But you are just as dead at 38 as you would be at 90. And the cessation of breathing in your life is but the belated announcement of an earlier death of the spirit.
Yes.
You died when you refused to stand up for right.
Yes.
You died when you refused to stand up for truth.
Yes.
You died when you refused to stand up for justice.
Yes, I hope Festus Keyamo will be hearing this from Asaba, Nigeria. Here comes the next senator for Death or Not. Death or Not, the senatorial constituency, Kenneth Gbandi. Welcome to Nigeria Now on ONN and the Nightingale Radio International. How are you? Are you hearing me?
Thank you so much. Thank you for reaching out. Like you can see, the background is a little bit dark, but welcome to Nigeria. Yes, I can hear you loud and clear.
Right. Okay. I apologize. Great. My sincere apologies for the late start. You know, we professional nurses, things can happen anytime, and we have to answer that call. That is the emergency. We got to save life. So that was why we started late. But all the same, I'm happy that we are here. Please introduce yourself to our global audience.
Thank you, sir. Again, like I said, thank you for having me on your program. I apologize for the background, which is a little bit dark. I'm in Nigeria, Asaba, Delta State Capital, for the to be precise. And yes, want to be real, want to be very, very real, and to have one of the reasons why we are back in Nigeria is to help make sure that we change most of the things that we think need to be fixed in Nigeria. And light is one of the most of the problematic, you know, aspect of that. But yes, Kenneth Chibok Ubane is my name. I'm the senatorial candidate for African Democratic Congress, ADC, to represent the good people of Delta North. Before now, I've been the continental chairman of Nigeria's in diaspora organization Europe, called NIDO. Before then, 4 years also, the chairman of Nigerian diaspora organization Germany. And then I represented the good people of Africa in Hamburg Senate Integration by Rats. And then, I joined my colleagues like you to search in, you know, to go in search of homeland development. So thank you for having me on your program, sir.
Thank you. Welcome. Intimidating credentials. And yeah. I hope we take it to Abuja. Now, quickly, you know, give us, you were born in Nigeria, you know, I know you live in Germany with your family. And can you tell us a little bit about what upbringing in Nigeria was for you before you took that dive and went and got yourself in Europe with precisely Germany?
Well, I used to say that I, at the age of 12 years old, I was the manager for my mother. I sold akara in the market. I sold clothes in the market. I knew what it is to, you know, to be, you know, a homeboy. I call myself proudly an Anioma homeboy. I'm in a family of 10. I'm the last born of the family. I call myself the Benjamin of the family. And before then, like I said, I knew virtually all the markets in Delta North, in Anioma, because I used to help my mother to, you know, to sell the clothes and other necessary foodstuffs in the market. Then growing up from there, I attended the University of Calabar, where I have my first degree in Geography and Regional Planning. Served at National NYSC, where I was liaison officer and graduated with an astounding service, a state award for an outstanding service, before proceeding to Germany, where I have been in the last 28 years in search of homeland development. So I consider myself as an Anioma homeboy with a very down-to-earth upbringing, knowing what it is to grow up in a village without light, without water, knowing what it is to assist your mom and your father in the farm, to be able to feed the family. And yes, I will consider myself as having a very, very humble upbringing, and I'm very, very proud of my Anioma ancestral roots, sir.
Thank you. You made mention about knowing nearly all the markets in the town or Anioma, as they call it. Did you ever get a chance to go to the Abavo market where you were traveling from this market, one marketplace to the other?
I would be glad to tell you, yes, I did. Abavo market, Umunede market, Onicholona market, Ogwashuku market, Ela market, Ebu market. Yes, I'm very, very proud that I visited those markets in my youth. Yes, I do.
So what were you selling at the time?
Well, I sell clothes. My mom is what they call a industrialist of our time. She used to make buns, she used to make soda, soap. She used to sew clothes, and she used to do everything you have to call, the modern fashion designing and bakery, different kind of food items. So I sell everything that is, every mother, needs to survive in the very early days, I think in the 70s and the 60s.
Thank you. Well, you served, you are a man of service. Germany, you represented African people at the Senate in Germany. What was your experience like?
Well, when I came to Germany, the first thing I realized, of course, I came after my first degree. I realized that the impression about Nigerians and Africans generally in Germany was not actually what I used to know. I mean, they see or they think most people from Africa, especially Nigeria, we live in the treetops, we don't have electricity in the house and the rest of them. And I tell them, excuse me, in Ikoyi, in Lagos, in Abuja, we have most of the most beautiful houses, better than what we have in Germany. So I think it's purely misinformation they don't actually understand what Africa is all about, rather than being, out of prejudice, but it's out of lack of information. So what I did was to establish the first black magazine in Germany, if I might use that word, African Heritage Magazine. The major idea was purely, to educate the people about Africa and about Nigeria, and that we are more than what they think we are. So that was actually my first beginning. And the idea was to change perspective, to change narrative, and avoid the danger of a single story. But I realized that while we have made a lot of improvement, while we have made a lot of achievement on that, for instance, Genevieve, one of the Nigerian Nollywood actress, her first international award was organized by myself and my team. We have the Lancelot, people like Lancelot Imaswe, who is called the governor, one of the best directors in Nigeria, Emeki K, Pat Atta, Lillian Bach, and the rest of them. We have had a lot of them in Germany. The idea is to paint a different impression, picture about Nigeria and Nigerians and Africans in general. So having done that through the different media we registered, I realized that media alone cannot change the perspective. Why we contributed to that, we need to do more than that. And I realized that politics sets the rules for the governance of our everyday life. Politics sets the rules of the do's and don'ts in the society to an extent. And that was why I felt that while media is good, I need to get involved in politics. So I contested for the Hamburg Senate Advisory Council and became the second black person in the history of Germany to win that, and the first Nigerian to win that, where we helped to formulate laws that governs not only Nigerians, but migrants in Germany. And eventually I was elected as the chairman of Anti-Discrimination Committee or the House Committee on Anti-Discrimination. And I'm proud to say that through my leadership, we're able to set laws and write what we call the integration concept that helps to guide most of the migrants in Hamburg as of today. So I believe you need to get out of the comfort zone, get involved in politics, because you need to help to change the narrative and then set the rules that governs the society to some extent.
Great. One question. Germany has a history of the past, Second World War. Now, what has changed from your understanding, or from you living in Germany, between then and now?
A lot. I think Germany, they are very, very aware of their past. Very, very aware of their past. And they are trying as much as possible, first, not to repeat the mistake of the past, but also to do as much as possible to atone, you know, for the decision of the past. So far, you know, people say that Germany is a police state, I agree. But when people say Germany is a racist state, I disagree. While we have a lot of racism in Germany, no doubt about it. If you look at what happens in UK and in US, Germany is far, far, far more advanced and more, you know, integrated in terms of, you know, trying to, you know, to correct the mistakes of the past. My experience is that I contested in German Advisory Council, in their Senate, so to say, to represent the foreigners. I doubt whether a German will have the opportunity to contest in Nigeria, you know, to become a lower house of the Senate. I doubt that. And for the fact that I am able, you know, to contest an election in Germany and win an election or won an election in Germany, it means that the society is open and they are, you know, they are open for change. And so if you ask me, the German of the 1914s are actually a different Germany today. And if you ask me, depends on who is defining that. Germany is one of the most advanced countries in the world today. The third largest economy in the world, or the fourth, depending on who is defining it. So yes, Germany is a metropolitan country as of today. And then they have just declared themselves as a migrant country. And so a lot of things have changed in Germany positively.
Great, great. Now, welcome back to Nigeria. The Senate. Your aspiration to go to the Senate to represent Delta North. I have traveled that road before. All right, 2019, I was in that race. And so much happened. What is your experience that you would like to share with us?
My experience is that politics in Nigeria is controlled by stomach infrastructure, money. And they believe that as long as you have money to spend, you know, you are probably, you know, one of the best candidates. That's number one. My second experience is that when I wrote out my manifesto, my policy, one of the flagship policy is to create 120,000 jobs in Delta North within 4 years. A lot of people, you know, laugh and said, you are not the governor. So what makes you think you have the ability to create jobs in Delta North? And that is why I'm different from most of the politicians. And I tell them, I don't need to be a governor to create jobs in Delta North. It's thinking outside the box. And I ask people, why do you have constituency projects? I mean, we know that a couple of people are probably in prison today because they siphoned the constituency project rather than using it for the people. So if one is a visionary leader, you understand that you don't need to be the governor to create employment and create, you know, jobs in Nigeria. All you need to do is to use the mandate which the people have given to you, leverage on whatever international or national connection you have, and create opportunities. What Nigerians need, what Delta North needs, are just opportunities. Open up the opportunities. Nigerians are one of the most hardworking people on earth. Give them the opportunities, provide the level playing environment, and they will excel. If you look at in Nigeria today, the World Trade Chairman of the World Trade Center, World Trade Organization, is a Nigerian, Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala, who has been, you know, declared by Forbes as one of the most powerful women in the world today. Adesina of the African Democratic Bank is a Nigerian, and you can name them. The Trade Minister, both in the UK, and the Junior Trade Minister, also in US, are both Nigerians. So you understand that we have a lot of things to offer. We just need to think outside the box. So my experience is that Nigerians, especially Delta Northerners, will have to begin to think that people, you know, representing people is about service. And the list of the people who can serve you are the people who actually have the mandate or should have the mandate to represent you. And so my experience is that we have to begin to go out from big politics, we begin to go out from big money, to begin to focus on individuals that have the Delta Northerners at heart, the individuals that have Nigerians at heart, irrespective of the size of their pocket.
we should look at the track record of those individuals, what they have done in the past, nationally and internationally, and based on that, judge them and be able to give them the mandate to bring in, you know, new perspective, new thinking to politics in Nigeria. They said that it's a madness to do the same thing all over again and expect a different result. After 20 years of trying and by error, or trying different political parties, it is time we do something different. And I think it's not only about Kenneth Gbandi, it's time we try new people who have new ideas across board, you know, to be able to bring out what I think is the you know, what the best, what politics stands for, which is service. And I'm hoping that a lot of people are getting that, and I'm hoping that they're going to implement it come February next year.
Thank you very much. Listeners from within Nigeria and around the world, you've been listening to Kenneth Gbandi, senatorial candidate for Delta North under ADC for the 2023 election. We'll be right back. Be right back. Fellow Nigerians, our country is going through one of its worst moments in history. The state of Nigeria requires all of us, regardless of where we are on earth, to come out of our comfort zones, to battle for our soul. Our country is under siege on all fronts. Welcome back. Right. Kenneth Gbandi. All right. It looks like. Did you mute your. All right. Good. Now, welcome back. Delta North. Senatorial District has for a very long time been in the trap of a very, very corrupt establishment. For you to be anything, you have to condescend and bow to their cult. It's a cult. They apportion every position to themselves and call it power sharing, especially people who don't have anything to offer. How are you going to break the yoke of this darkness in that state and emerge the next senator for Delta that has been without a senator for nearly 9 months right now?
Thank you for that question. Steve Jobs said that those people who are crazy enough to think that they will change the world are the people that normally actually do. That's number one. And number two, they said that there's no army in the world to stop a thing that its time has come. If you look at the current dispensation or the current phenomenon going on in Nigeria, irrespective of political party or individual attached to that phenomenon, there's a new awareness in Nigeria. There's a new awareness where they believe that our mumu don't do. There's a new awareness where they believe that, you know, politicians comes around every 4 years to give them 3,000 naira, and after that they disappeared to come back the next 4 years. They begin to realize that the money they share to them is our commonwealth, it's their money. They begin to realize that individuals are the focus of 2023 election rather than political parties. They begin to realize, I mean, if you look at the social media, if you look at the current media, you see that our elected politicians, not only in Delta State, not only in Delta North, but across Nigeria, are being accosted by youth, by credible individuals across the country, asking them for accountability. So it is time of accountability. I believe that the time has come where people are going to rise beyond mundane things. They're going to rise beyond these stomach infrastructures to begin to ask critical questions. I've been traveling around the Delta North in the past 1 year. I've met youth leaders. Currently, it might interest you that as of today in Asaba, Delta State, I was awarded the Nigerian Youth Council Award for political and voters education. It might also interest you that tomorrow I'll be going to Onicholona because I've been given an honorary doctorate degree by Ecclesia's body of international reports, and they are doing that for my leadership quality and the defense of the Christian faith. As we speak today, I was at the National Stadium where they are doing the sports festival, where some Anioma youth, you know, insisted that I should come and address them because they think that, you know, I represent a political fresh breath. They believe I represent something new in Delta North. They totally agree with what you have just analyzed, where political positions are apportioned rather than being on merit. And they think that time for such political apportion in Delta North should be over, and it's over. And they see people like Kenneth Gbandi as a new breed, a new face to begin to right the wrongs of the Delta North in the last. And that's one thing. The second thing is that also, while they are coming based on the party name, I am coming with policies. I'm coming with projects, what we are going to do to change the life of the Delta North youth. And like I said, my first 4 years in office, I'm going to create 120,000 jobs. This is not rocket science. Secondly, within my next 4 years, I think that one of the priorities I have is to sponsor a bill at the Senate to stop the irresponsible jumbo Senate salary. And until that bill is passed, that a very chunk portion of my Senate salary will be dedicated to social system of Delta Northern youths, where they're going to be having a stipend every month from the chunk of that salary until we can get them an employable job where they can do. But while doing that, we're going to involve in a massive use capacity building. As we speak, we have a work ongoing across the airport where we're going to construct 550 units diaspora estate. That diaspora estate is going to be involved 100% by direct youth labor. So we'll train the plumbers, they will train the electricians, we'll train the bricklayers, and after training them with a modern way of doing things, we deploy them into that housing project. And once we do that, they go out from the welfare scheme to become fully employed to help them and their family. So these are the projects we are bringing on board. For the past 2 months, we've been going on diaspora medical mission. We brought the best doctors from Germany, from Europe. While our leaders are going outside this country to go and treat themselves when they're having a medical issue, we are bringing experts from Germany to come and treat them. And so far, we have attended over 3,000 patients across Anioma. This is just a tip of iceberg of what is to come to domesticate best legislative, international best legislative practice, to legislate what is happening abroad, what is happening in Germany, in UK, United States, to tell people that being a leader means being a servant. And you are not lording over the people, but you're bringing in innovative ideas. Politicians are meant to solve problems, not to cry over the problem. We have identified the problem we have in Delta North. A lot of youth are out of job. Our medical facilities are at almost near zero. Infrastructure that, we can just go on and on and on. 13% derivative formula from oil earnings. Delta State is one of the top five earning so much. Like Dr. Governor Wike just mentioned, where are all this money that we are getting? Where are they being invested on? These are the things we need to begin to speak at. And as a senator, there's going to be a robust, oversight function where such projects will be critically analyzed. And those people who are meant to implement that project are meant to answer questions what they're doing with our money.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Kenneth, I hit again. Data not. I'm speaking from experience. Data not. The people, the leaders. What now? Let me ask you with specifics. When I ran for Senate, the traditional institution, we are very openly sold out. What is your experience today with the array of people who we look up to for traditional leadership that are supposed to be neutral, but have been, you know, in politics, like they are political errand boys, to the extent that our tradition is beginning to lose value. Have you observed any such thing, or have they made amend, or they are playing away now and are allowing people express themselves the way it ought to be?
I would say, I will put it this way. We are in a new era where things are not just business as usual. We are in an era where people are beginning to speak up and ask questions. And so my experience so far, I would say that I've visited traditional rulers, to be specific. I visited the Obi of Idumujo Uboko, His Royal Highness. I visited the Obi of Obolono, who is also the Vice Chairman of the Delta State Traditional Council. I visited the Obi of Akumazi. I visited the Obi of Akukwibo, my Obi. And I can mention I visited the Omu of Anioma. I visited the Omu of Ibuzo. And in my consultation, they all have a very open mind to one thing. And that's what actually gladdens my heart. That irrespective of political affiliation, they think it's the time of the youth. They think it is time we have, you know, a change of political batting, irrespective of political parties. And they not only they wish for that, they pray for that. So I think that the thing we experienced in the past could be a problem, no doubt about it. But with a movement of what I call the age of enlightenment in Nigeria, that they begin to realize that also that they cannot be business as usual. So my prayer and my hope is that our traditional leaders should live up to the name and the office they hold, and not acting like a political errand boy, like you mentioned. And like I said, my experience so far has been very, very wonderful, and I pray it will continue. It will continue that way.
Great to hear that. Now, what is the attitude of the young people in Delta, those that you have encountered? Because they were my focus all through the race, and they have remained my focus, youths across Nigeria. How are they responding to your message?
To be honest with you, I would say it's a mixed feeling. It's a mixed feeling, yeah, to put it that way. We have some youths who are really, really bent on a change. I'll give you, without patronize myself. Like I said, I went to stadium today, you know, as a part of the sports festival going on in Lagos. And I was baffled that, you know, people stopped me on the road to say, "Sir, are you not Mr. Gbandi who is running for Senate?" And I said, "Wow." I mean, we have, if you look at the, you know, a media report of the sports, we have thousands of people in the stadium, and to be singled out, you know, means that the awareness is growing. And what I hear is that, sir, please do not be discouraged. We know we have a lot of, you know, Goliaths in Delta North, like you rightly say, you know, in our last few minutes ago. But they said, please don't remember that David took down Goliath, and you are the Goliath, you are the David of Delta North. And it's very, very heartwarming to see youth, you know, telling you, giving you that that idea, or giving you that motivation or that pet up. But unfortunately, also you also encounter some group of youth who, although they agree, they believe that things have to change in Nigeria, they believe we have to do something about it, but they will say something that actually very, you know, very amazing. They will say, "Yeah, we know you're a better alternative. Yeah, we know you're doing very well. But, you know, nothing can happen without, you know, financial inducement." And I said, "No, you can't be here and here at the same time. You either be here or you are there. You cannot tell me that you know that this is a good thing to do. You cannot tell me that you know this is the right person. And at the same time, you're saying that until money exchanges hands, then you can't do the right thing. Then you're not ready to do the right thing." And so they get irritated when I say that. They get irritated when I say that the politics we are coming to play in Nigeria is not a do-or-die affair politics. I must not do everything and anything to be elected. I am coming to tell the people of Delta North, the people of Anioma, what I could do differently. I'm coming to tell people of Anioma that with my 28 years of global leadership experience, that I have what it takes, you know, to have the international connect, international partners to come and make Delta North the best investment destination in the whole of Nigeria and whole of Delta. I have a project, a flagship project for agro-industrial initiative, where we can create agro-enclave in the 9 local government area of Delta North, not only providing employment for youth, but also providing livelihood for the people and generating wealth for all, and also guarantee food security. These are the things I'm going to bring to Delta North. And if you believe me and you think we can do this together, then I'm your man. But if anybody wants me to come and share money for people because they said you have to do the way they do it to be there before you change things, then I'm the wrong candidate and you're the wrong person for me. But like I said, so far, so good. I take the honor to consider myself as the David of Delta North. And like we know, the biblical story, what happened to between David and Goliath. So I'm very, very optimistic.
Great. Now, what is your experience with the older generation? Let's shift from the young people now. You know, yes, this is their time. This is their moment. You know, we created that pathway. You know, my message was youth-centric all the time. And they responded very well until the very last minute. Well, what is your experience with the older generation, those who are 50, 45, 50, up to 60, and then above?
Well, I like when I answer such questions, I give facts rather than, you know, just the, you know, painting words. I met the president generals of Oshimili and Yocha, or the president general. They had a meeting in Iseloku, and the president generals are the leaders of our community, like, you know, in these two local government areas. I met them to give them the message of hope, the message of change. And after I finished my presentation, what we intend to do for Delta North, you know, agro enclaves, youth capacity building, you know, passing a bill, you know, to stop the irresponsible jumbo salary of the Senate, doing youth capacity building, across board, quote me, I'm on camera, I'm on international live camera, international studio. They said, after listening to my presentation, it is obvious that their generation need to be retired from politics because they have a new set of individuals that understand what it takes to move not only Nigeria, but to move Delta North forward. So, based on that premises, they agree, they realize that they have been in politics for a very long time, but, you know, there comes a time in life where you have to say, you know what, we have done our best, it's time to give way, you know, to the new generation, a political new generation, to make the difference. So my experience so far is that I've always, you know, go out from wherever I've been to with blessings and prayers to say, you have, you know, made a good representation, and we pray that the Almighty God will continue to be with you. And they claim, or they say they are going to give me their own support. But they say the taste of the pudding is in the eating. And so February will be the result of such, you know, affirmation. But I can tell you so far, I have a very, very good feeling that they believe that it's time for a change.
Great. Now, Mr. Kenneth Gbandi, what is the source of your money? How are you financing your campaign? How are you funding yourself? That is a gigantic project. You know, when they talk about, when the people start telling you that you have to give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar. I told them then Caesar did not give me anything, so I'm not giving him anything.
Well. It's a challenge, you see. Politics anywhere in the world, whether in the United States, whether in Germany, whether in Nigeria, you know, takes money. The only difference is that I say that logistics, yes, but, you know, sharing of money counts me out. to use the word of a very known political movement, we know they give shishi, you know. And so either you take what we are providing, you know, or you probably think, you know, we are not the right candidate for you. But I'll give you another example of what is the political movement we are experiencing. We're in international TV studio, so people can also verify that. We've been to, went to Iseloku to meet with the youth in Iseloku. And yes. Then after we have been subjected to a lot of questions and answers, and after making my presentation, the youth began to contribute money together.
Wow.
To support the project. And they said, we want to demonstrate that the time has passed for politicians to come and buy them with money, because they are convinced with what we are saying, because they are convinced with what we are doing. They contributed their money. In fact, I felt so bad to collect the money, because I said that actually they need all the money in the world to do all the grass work and mobilization. But out of respect, I collected just 2,000 naira from that money they donated, and I donated the rest of the money, about 10 or 20,000, back to them, that they needed to do mobilization. So, you know, I am counting on goodwill people. I'm counting on the goodwill of the people of Delta North, of the international community, our very, very good elders in Nigeria, who believe in our message of change, not the kind of change we have before now, who believe in the message of, you know, something radically, you know, to come about the development of this country, to come about, you know, the dividends of democracy. And I'm seeing a lot of positive experience on that. On the other side, they say you have to put your money where you have to.
Yeah, temporarily.
To be able to raise money, because I believe in the cause I'm pursuing. I believe in the cause of serving the people of Delta North, and I think I have to also do my part, you know, by raising as much as I can, and hoping that the good people like you, who have a very, very gigantic international network, should come also in our support to make sure that we'll be able to raise enough funds for the last 2 months of the election.
Great. Now, you have some opponents, and one is Ned Nwoko. He ran in 2019, but he did not run beyond his party thing because he was not a candidate of the establishment. And then I hear, sadly, that Peter Nwaoboshi, who has been sentenced to 7-year jail term, is still in the race to the Delta North senatorial district election. What's going on? Is this true? Can you please confirm this?
Well, like you, we've read in the media about he has been by the court of competent jurisdiction been convicted tampering with our commonwealth. But like every other person also, I'm still seeing his name on the ballot paper. So that's going to be the job of INEC and our legal system to be able to, you know, to sort out that such abnormality. But I will tell you in all sincerity, I think Ned Nwoko is basically an opponent that most people are talking so much about. That is going to be a contest between myself and Ned Nwoko, for the fact that a lot of people also like you are thinking that Senator Peter Nwaoboshi, you know, is out of circulation, and for the fact that he's being convicted by a court of competent jurisdiction, cannot also be running for election. I mean, that's the feeling I have on the ground. But whatever be the case, I am coming to represent the people of Delta North. My contract is with the people of Delta North. And so my presentation is to address the people of Delta North, to tell them what I'm going to do for them, irrespective of whoever is contesting. And I'm sure, and I trust the judgment of Delta North, that they will choose light. They will choose light over darkness, that they will choose right over wrong, that they will choose a political fresh breath rather than doing the same thing all over again and expecting a different result. So my focus is to actually to tell the people of Delta North that it's a new dawn in political in the political scene, and to count on their support to make this a reality.
Okay, good. Well, I was wondering if you have enough money to kill mosquitoes in the media. Have you been to the North Pole?
Well, I will probably try that. If it's going to bring the Delta North, if it's going to make the life of Delta North better, if it's going to bring prosperity to Delta North, yes, I will try that. But if it's not going to bring prosperity to Delta North, I will focus on, you know, revolutionizing the agricultural system. I will focus on youth empowerment, you know, project, the thing that I know that will bring meaning to people of Delta North.
All right, Kenneth, you made mention of one thing. You know, I don't give people advanced questions. When I ask questions, I ask randomly, just the way from what you are saying. You made mention about empowerment. You know, that word empowerment, are you with me?
I'm with you.
All right. That word empowerment, you know, when they say it in Nigeria now, or any Nigerian says it, I feel like throwing up because it doesn't make sense anymore. So can you give more light to the type of empowerment you want to give to our people? Is it the same type of empowerment where people will gather young people and give them chicken and then put them on the face of in front of cameras, and then people are yelling and shouting that he came to empower us? So how are you going to empower our people? Is it through policy? Through policy or by giving them handouts?
I love your question, because they go into the heart of what I do. In 2021, we brought in professionals from Germany, from United States, from United Kingdom, and we trained Delta North youth, over 200 of them, on youth capacity building. And surprisingly, immediately after the training, they asked me, where is the empowerment? Because they are used to, after every empowerment, you give them 2,000, 20,000 naira, 10,000 naira, and then that's what they call empowerment. And I said, no, that is not the kind of empowerment we're doing. We have a different set of empowerment. How? My experience in Germany is that a Chinese will come to Nigeria with $50,000 provided by the Chinese investment bank, or supported by Chinese investment bank. And he comes to Nigeria, and after 2 years or 1 year, he'll be running one of the best agricultural, you know, establishments in Nigeria, or running one of the best shop in Nigeria. For me, that is empowerment. You know, a typical Nigerian, not all Nigerians, will sell their father's property, their father's land or the house, to travel to abroad with the same amount, with no guarantee he's going to succeed in Germany or in Europe or in America, because if his care is not taken, he's going to be repatriated back. So the question is, what are we doing wrong? And that is why it's important to understand that with the 50,000 they are going to sell to go and look for a visa, there are possibilities of things around us, just like what the Chinese and the Japanese are seeing and coming to Nigeria to be able to make life a better life out of 2 years. So we need to look at the local environment. So what we're trying to do with the empowerment or the youth capacity building is to try to explore the opportunities around us, because the kind of education we have, our educational system that prepares to go and look for a white-collar job after you finish your university degree, without thinking of what can you do to generate or create wealth. So these are the things we try to do in terms of empowerment, by trying to empower, to build human capacity. So our empowerment is human capacity building, where they will have the opportunity and they have the tools, especially mechanical tools or, you know, or soft tools, to be able to look at their environment and be able to be creation of wealth, or the creators of wealth, rather than the consumption of wealth. So these are the kind of empowerment we are doing, rather than bringing in before the camera to give 2,000 or 10,000 naira and call that empowerment.
Okay, I get it now. Now, electoral reform. A lot of people are hailing Buhari for the electoral reform he made.
Can you say that you are completely satisfied with the electoral reform, especially seeing criminals running in elections in Nigeria? I know they are not allowed to run in Germany, and I know they are preemptively screened out. You don't even hear anything about the election. But in Nigeria, I ran against a young woman who committed a huge credit card fraud here. He returned to Nigeria and became a member of the House of Representatives for 4 years. And during my time, he ran for Senate on the platform of APC. And right now, she's running. The same thing, Nwaoboshi has a litany of legal cases. So don't you think, as a senator, would you consider introducing a legislation that will preemptively screen out any person who has any bad criminal record from accessing our electoral system?
Well, I think you said it all. That is actually, it's electoral reforms. It's not about who runs for election. It's also the process of also generating or producing that person who runs for election. So that you're totally correct. And then to answer the question, no, I'm not 100% satisfied. But I believe it's also a right step in the right direction. No two ways about it. You know, because they say that a journey of 1,000 kilometers begins with a step. So we think that the step has started in the right direction, but a lot could be done. Now, I will tell you that in one of my appearances in the flagship of NTA program, Good Morning Nigeria, I'll tell people that if you have a two political party, APC PDP or PDAPC or APPDC, as it depends on how you would define it. A two political party that was able to raise 7 billion in just 2 months do not care about the followership. And that is why they could not cultivate followership, because they don't bloody care about the followership, because they know that they have 7 billion to share during the election and buy vote and buy people all over. And so part of the electoral reform is also to be able to produce legitimate people like you just mentioned. And to do that, you need to remove money, big money from politics, where a character of a person and the son of nobody will become the son of somebody just because he has the ability and the competence to contest for an election. And so these are the things we think we need to change, in our electoral reform system. Also, in Germany, where you cross a certain threshold in your primaries, the state automatically funds your campaign. By so doing, you eliminate godfathers. You eliminate people who have the tendency or who have the money backs to control policy and control, the way your vision and your thinking. So I think a lot of things need to be done. But the important thing is that you can never get this reform if the same wrong people begin to always appear at the legislative picture, because you cannot tell somebody to sentence himself to life sentence. They are coming there because they are the only profession they have, to squander our commonwealth. And so the only way we can stop them is to bring credible people who their life depends on whether they're going to, depends on our commonwealth, or people who are willing to carry out reform for the benefit of all Nigerians, for the benefit of everybody. So these are the kind of reforms we need to bring to continue from what we have now, but to extend it to a reform, a political reform that will benefit the common man and not only a selected few.
Thank you. Now, for the sake of accountability, especially for you as a candidate, Delta North has 9 local government areas and about 1,400 and something polling booths. Do you have enough men to man all the booths there for you, to ensure that you are not shortchanged? Not just having anybody, do you have people you believe that you can trust, relatively in Nigeria, because trust now is expensive in Nigeria, that can do the work, be your foot soldiers, be your eyes, and do what they are expected to do with knowledge, with the background understanding that there are consequences, for some of these bad, sharp practices that we think has become, unfortunately, a tradition in our country. How do you intend to handle that? This is very critical. I'm offering you an advice now based on experience so that you don't fall into the type of thing, because a lot of young people still took my money and they never showed up. Yeah, they just went and were laughing like they don't catch another mugu. So I wouldn't want you, because I know how hard you work. I know how hard I work. We don't steal. We just work legitimately. What brings us to Nigeria to want to do something different is a love of country. So how do you intend to do this?
To be honest with you, it's a challenge. Out of 9 local government area, we are sure to have zeroed down at least 6 local government areas where we have such a comprehensive manpower. But we think we still have two months to go. Based on the December deadline of INEC, I think we should be able to get the remaining 6, 7, 8, 9 local government areas to come on board. But honestly speaking, like you said, it's a challenge. But our consolation is that based on the mini electoral reform, like you just mentioned, where electronic voting is very, very, it's going to be used. What happens live at the polling station has probably less consequence as of before, compared to before than now, since it's going to be electronic voting. But of course, like we said, that does not mean we must not fulfill that requirement where you have your eyes and your ears on the polling booth.
Great. Now, as a senator, would-be senator, I would love you. I'm very partisan in this matter right now because of the factors and the forces at play. Hello, are you with me?
I'm with you, sir.
All right. You are a senator, a senatorial candidate coming from the diaspora, coming from Germany to Nigeria, where some people think that they will come and tell you that this is Nigeria, this is not Germany, go back to Germany. In fact, in my own case, they told me to go back to my country. So like I wasn't a Nigerian anymore, go back to America where you come from. Here, this is Nigeria, this is say softly, you know, you ought to stay in line and wait for the people on the ground to have their way before you. They will tell you to belong to the system, understand the system. Do you hear any such thing like you are learning how to be a medicine seller?
I don't know if I had your last question, because you were a little bit the network was a little bit
The question was, you come from outside Nigeria, because some of them want to see you as an alien. Even if you are a Nigerian, you were born there, you know, you belong to that jungle. That's what I was telling them. I say out of a jungle does not make a monkey, not being a member of that jungle. I just stepped out. Did you see any situation where people made you look like you're a stranger to Nigeria, or especially to your data?
Absolutely.
And then they will tell you that you need to learn the culture. You want to you don't jump into it like this. You have to, you know. They will tell you like this. You have to, you know. How would you say, man? Just be like that. Make you learn. All right. Learn the rope. What is there to learn in Nigeria? Have you been told any such?
Of course, I tell them that the diaspora between the last 3 years remitted over $64 billion, which is keeping the economy alive. And I'll tell them that the diaspora who are supporting the economy of Nigeria are also good enough to also help in deciding who govern this country, and also help to decide So I think they are living in a olden age. The time has passed where we are going to, listen to such a derogatory word, so to say. I'm a Nigerian by birth. I'm a Nigerian by citizen, and like every other person else, I have a right, to join in building a new country. I think it's out of ignorance rather than out of lack of information rather than being out of jealousness, so to say. So it is people like both of us that have to join hands to educate them, that that's not them. If you follow the biblical story, the diaspora has actually always been in the forefront of making a change in every country, from Israel to India to Australia. Nigeria cannot be an exception. And I think it's time for us, the diaspora, to join hands, you know, with our folks in Nigeria to bring about a new Nigeria.
Okay, somebody here is, says he wants to ask you a question. Jennifer. Jennifer, yes, you can ask a question. And if you are still on, he said he has a question to ask. Jennifer, what is the question? If you want to call, you can call the number +1 832 407 6282. So he can hear your question. If you are still up there, just give us the call. Then I will have him listen to the question. I'll put him on speaker so he can hear the question. Thank you. All right. While we wait for Jennifer, let's go to something else. You've seen this sorry state of healthcare in Nigeria, and you've seen the sorry state of education, public education in Nigeria. Let's not put private now. Public, that is where the ordinary man children go to. That was where you and I went to, and this is who we are. You see, the quality is different from what we are seeing today. I know. All right, that's Jennifer calling right there. All right, Jennifer, Jennifer, you are on. Go ahead, ask your question.
Hello.
Yes, Jennifer, you are on. Yes.
Coincidentally, I've been in the same group with him on one of these WhatsApp platform.
Yes.
Group platform.
Yes.
I am indeed really glad to hear from him today. I've seen what he's doing in the Delta North. But I want to ask one or two questions.
Go ahead.
He mentioned something about youth empowerment. But I want to go further into talking about employment. I have been in Abuja for quite some time now, and I noticed that the employment style in the north is different from that of the south. I see that in the north you can get someone. Someone with a lower degree for a job, and while the Southerner is not given such opportunity, what I'm trying to say is that the Northerners are given a job and they can upgrade while at a job, but when it comes to the Southerner, most of the time, which I've also been a victim with your degree, many times you are asked to do masters for you to earn a job. So how are you going to remove this, how will I call it now, this situation from the lives of our youth? Because a lot of our youth are actually jobless when they actually have this qualification. That was one question. Then the second question is having to do with educational system. For me, I feel our curriculum is out of date. So, and are you going to talk about bringing in history, geography, some of the subjects that have been scrapped from our educational system? Those are my questions. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Jennifer. All right, our senator, incoming senator, over to you.
Well, the first question is, I totally agree with her. The phenomenon she expressed. It means, or not? It means we need to address those issue through a constitutional reform where all the, you know, the part of the country are equally represented. We need to, you know, to pursue aggressively a reform where, you know, there is equality. Everybody feel, you know, happy being a Nigerian and being, you know, having his or her voice, you know, being heard and having his full representation. So the answer is aggressive, constitutional reform, and as well as, a robust oversight function for those people who are actually those institutions or MDAs who are, you know, are responsible for such implementation. So that's going to be, that's going to how I'm going to address that. On the issue of education, I'm just a senator. I'm not a governor or the president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. And so I will not, claim, to roll a magic wand to address that. But again, it's about also reform. So we need to look at our educational system, bring in, policy experts, address the issues you've just raised and make sure that, the decision and the policy of the expert are implemented, to the letter. Just to digress a little bit, we have the flood that devastated part of Niger, Niger Delta areas. Though I can't confirm that, but from the report, there's this report that the dam and the Nigerians and Cameroon need to build, a dam to checkmate the flood. And why the Cameroonian side has built theirs, they expected Nigerian side to, to build theirs also. The flood we're having in Nigeria today is as a result of that dam not being built. And I'm sure that when that thing was proposed, we have people who are representative, we have people who have an oversight function on such issues. And those people actually should be held responsible, even today, whether they're in office or not, for the loss of life and properties. So what is important is that when we have such good policies, they need to be a robust oversight function of those, such policies. While reform is dynamic, nothing is static. As we move in every day, we realize the mistakes of the past, we know how we can change that. So we craft policies that are going to address that. And not only having policies that address that, but also having a robust oversight function to make sure that those issues are being followed on a very on a consequential basis. So that's how I will actually address those issues you mentioned.
Thank you. National security compromise. Nigeria has become an embarrassment to the whole of Africa. It looks like we don't have a government that can firmly go after troublemakers in a manner that is fair and in a manner that is just to the people, the victims. It's like we don't have security operatives or security agencies. They exist in names. Anybody can be caught like a chicken on the street of Nigeria. In fact, not just anybody. They come in and take them in bus loads and they take them to wherever they want. Nobody is held accountable. Nobody is that we begin to pay ransom if we are lucky to have them alive. What is going on now as a senator and as a prospective senator and as one who is coming from the diaspora, coming from a country where there is security? You started by saying that people say Germany is a police state. Yes, I went to Germany actually some 5 years ago, and I got into it with one of the police officers. And he said, "Oh, we're American citizens." I was laughing. You know, Nigeria has like lost it. What is happening? What will you do? This is a very trying time for you to be aspiring to be a senator in Nigeria. What are you going to do to rally your colleagues into action to save the country? It looks like it's a connection issue is emanating from Nigeria. I do hope that Kenneth will come back and join us to answer this very, very critical question. We temporarily lost him, and listeners and viewers from across the world, Nigerians in particular, and some Africans who are in, you know, from the other side, you know, listening. We have been talking with Kenneth Gbandi. Kenneth Gbandi is a German-based U.S. German-based Nigerian, you know, who's aspiring to run for a seat at the Senate to represent Delta North. We have been having these serious discussions about the way forward for Nigeria and as it affects his proposed representation of Delta North is a senatorial district populated by some of the best intellectuals in Nigeria, but unfortunately being represented by darkness since the past 24 years. I think the people need a new pathway. Kenneth is stepping forward as the light after my attempt in 2019, and I hope that the people of Delta North sees the light and take the light and run with it, you know, so that we'll be free from the stranglehold of those who will do everything but serve their people. And then thankfully one of them is in jail, and then some more we go to jail, hopefully, and when sane men and come into that. Yeah, Kenneth is back. Let's bring him back on board to the stream. Yes. We're talking about the national security embarrassment in Nigeria. As a senator, what will you do? What legislation will you propose to really bring...
Yes, you're talking about the security.
Yes.
I have a background. Exactly.
Say that again.
Well, good enough. I have a background. I have a background in peace and security, which from University of Hamburg, which gave me insight into the activities of. I said I come with a background of peace and security from the University of Hamburg, and so which means I understand the activities of the state actors and non-state actors. But basically, what we will be addressing is simply security reform. No two ways about it. And one of the, just to take out from the many reforms we are going to embark on, to give a very good example, is the state police. You cannot have a police commissioner from one region to be a commissioner in another region where he does not understand the governed and the ungoverned space because of the local security network. It's not going to work. And that's why we're having a lot of ungoverned spaces in Nigeria where the bandits can, can walk freely. The second ambiguity of Nigerian security architecture is that we have a state governor who is supposed to be the chief security officer of the state. But the commissioner of the police does not take order from him. Rather, he takes order from the inspector general of police all the way in Abuja. So why do you call him the chief security of the state when he cannot command, when he cannot be in charge of the architecture? I'll give you a very good example. There's a case between the Lagos state governor and the residents of Magodo. And so when the residents of Magodo asked the governor to intervene, he came to Magodo and directed the police unit that came to that to withdraw their men, from that zone. And the police officer simply, was telling the governor that he cannot do that without getting an instruction from the commissioner of police, from the IG. So you can understand a governor of a state who is the chief security officer of a state telling a commissioner of a police officer in his state that he should pull his men out of a region where he has a control of, because he's of the opinion that he can settle that case, amicably. And they are telling him that they cannot obey the instruction from him because they are not getting any report from the IG. So these are the kind of contradictory security architecture we have in Nigeria that gives room to banditry, that people can operate with impunity, because the state governor, so to say, is not actually in charge of the security apparatus of the state. So such are the such issues, such architecture need a total reform where we'll be able to address those issues, to have a state police totally in support of state police, and also to have a security architecture where the governor of a state, of a particular state, is truly the chief security officer of that state. So these are the areas we'll be addressing. So security sector reforms is inevitable for us to have a very, very standard, robust, security system we need in Nigeria.
Okay. Do you agree with the way they recruit people into services in Nigeria, especially the armed services, armed forces in Nigeria, where they will tell you Delta bring 8, Enugu 10, Kano 15, Jigawa 5, and other? against a people or young men and women who truly want to serve their country from their hearts, walk to the recruitment places like it is here. I know in the United States, they called my son when he finished high school. They called me, actually. The recruiting officer came and met me. He said, oh, I'm looking for your son. Are you the father of this? I said, yes. And I have only one son. And then he said, we've been following him from high school. We know he's about to graduate. I wanted to know if he could serve in the U.S. Marine. I said, oh, you have to talk to him, not me. I'm not going to be the one making that type of decision for him. Now, they called him because of his size and his height. They called him, and then after they discussed with him, he called me and said, why would you allow these people to call me? You know, I'm an only son. You know, I don't have to join the U.S. Army and stuff like that. I said, well, I wanted you to make that decision. I won't be the one making that type of decision for you. And I remember growing up, people came to schools to recruit us for one thing or the other. So how has this helped us in terms of developing our armed forces, a real hard-fighting armed forces, not the one that paid his way or her way into them because his state must be represented? Do you think we have a way out of this so that we can have patriotic people coming into our armed forces who have the fire to fight, especially at moments like this?
To be honest with you, I will be, you know, assuming to know so much if I claim that I know how the armed forces are being recruited. Apart from the quota system, which you mentioned, which I know very well, the other intricacies, I'm not actually aware of that. I know that security system is something that, you know, one need to be an expert on that, you know, to be able to, you know, to work on that. But the truth is that if we agree, if we all agree that our current armed forces cannot defeat Boko Haram after, you know, how many years, you know, counterinsurgencies, then it is very obvious that something needs to be done. It is very obvious that you know, there are places we are not getting it right. So my contribution will simply be that we are going to review why an army that's supposed to be one of the best army in the world, or at least the best in Africa, cannot you know, flush out Boko Haram in a Zambezi forest where we know their location. We know their location, and so their inability to flush them out, you know, has to do with probably the theater of war operation. So we need to find out why such issues, they kept occurring, and we put her together with a security expert, and we can see exactly what are the necessary reforms we are going to do about that. One thing is clear, and one thing is for sure, that if our fighting soldiers are, you know, well equipped and doing the best they should be doing, then we won't be having the issue of Boko Haram today. So the fact boils down that we need to do something about it. And again, it boils down to the complete security sector reforms, where we're going to look into such a modus operandi of recruitment.
All right. For the sake of, we have a lot to talk. I'm going to have to bring you at least four more times before the election proper. Now, one thing that has been a serious problem is our justice system and the administration of justice in Nigeria. People commit crimes. The masterminds are never touched. The masterminds are known. They dance around them. And now that is, we have gotten to a country where people can go and eat anybody they like without consequences. What do you think about this? As a prospective senator, you know, I'm going to asking you, these are all senatorial questions, things that you'll be confronting, things that people before you have never thought about. They go out there to share money and cry. Sometimes some of them will get crocodile tears. And then you can imagine a scene where, you know, Melaye was like a champion, you know. How would you expect that type of country to move forward? Now, let's go back to that. Our justice system. Criminals run the system now. Everything has been hijacked. They will kill people. They know the killers. They won't touch them. They dance about it, waste time. And even lawyers are involved. And government prosecutors are involved. They form a ring and destroy evidence. Justice is not served. What do you think should be done or can be done? Assuming, hopefully, you are elected a senator. Because
what differentiates most of the African countries? What differentiates most of the African countries from the Western world is called the rule of law. When there is a rule of law, it means that nobody is above the law. And once nobody is above the law, it means that every crime has consequences. And the consequences should be followed to a logical conclusion. Where you have a place, a country, where some individuals are above the law, that's what actually we were saying. Where you have non-criminals, where you have non-convicted people who go around with impunity, where we have public servants fainting in court, claiming that crocodiles or monkeys has swallowed our money, and the rest of them, or snake has swallowed our money, or reptiles. This is what my media it calls these are known creatures, reptiles that swallows Nigerians' money, and at the end of the day. We have a situation where the SSS or DSS or NIA, found a house in somewhere in Ikoyi, where we have, they stash a lot of dollars, and today we don't have any answers. Who is, who owns that money? Who is responsible for that? And so on and so on. So we have a place where people get away with crime because they are not being held, accountable for their actions. And so what we need to do is to have a country of rule of law, where nobody is above the law. And once we begin to have that, then our justice system begin to make meaning. Because when you convince a criminal today, tomorrow he's on the street tomorrow with the best of the SUV cars, doing parties and the rest of them, it have an impunity to other people to do more. And so my take still boils down to reforms. Reforms. Nigeria need to, to have a total reform. But having said that, also the leadership, the quality of leadership we bring in place makes a lot of difference. That's why sometimes you see that people, directly or indirectly, so that our Mr. President, who is the chief security officer, is also responsible for the actions or inactions with regard to what happens in the country, because his body language means a lot. I will give a very simple example. If I am the president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria and the school kids are being kidnapped in any part of the country, Zamfara, for instance, as the president, I will fly down to Zamfara within the next 24 hours and I will summon all the security apparatus in around that zone and I will give them 48 hours to get these guys, find them, arrest them, or get themselves considered sack. So the body language of the leader matters. The attitude of our leaders matters. So while we combine the leadership quality as one, we also have a situation where we're going to have accountability in Nigeria and the respect for law and the rule of law as a panacea, to most of this problem you just highlighted.
Good. Somebody, Charles Ogumba from California, United States, has this to say, and I bet perhaps he has already asked the calling number. He said, Nigerian legislators, I have a gun pointed to their heads. Their heads are tied. Their hands are tied. The scope and range of their proposals are limited in scope. There are certain proposals they cannot make. And he went further to say, the people in a community ought to be responsible for their own security, to hire and fire. It must be a force accountable to them that implements Nigerian laws, which are already written and non-ambiguous. It must be a force that does not account to anyone offsite, but to the people. The governor should not have the right to control the police. In no US state is the US president or state governor in charge of police. Well, that is a fact that we live through here. What do you have to say about this? Mr. Ogumba, maybe we would like to speak with you, you know, so that we can expatiate on this. This is the first thing he had to say. I hope you are reading it, my brother. Ken, are you able to see what he wrote? I put it
yes,
right
sir,
there.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I read it.
Okay. All right. That's number
well,
one.
I think it's partially correct. When I say partially correct, every politics is local, and and the security architecture is also has to do with the local the governance in place. That's why I can only say that what we need to do is have the best international practice that exists across the board and try to see how we can implement it in the country. But the good thing that I have to say, by design or by hand of God, almost 65% of the legislators currently in Nigeria are not going to go back because they signed their death warrant. In the fact that during the electoral reforms, they signed some the reforms that actually prevented them from coming back. So it means that 65% of the old politicians are going to go and 65% of new electorates are going to be on board, so to say. And it means that these are going to be, legislators with a different mindset and are coming, to Nigeria with hope, I believe, for a new Nigeria. So their hands being tied and their gun being on their heads might be a thing of the past. It depends on, on eventually the number of percentage of people that, find their way to the legislative chamber. So the chairman says that hope die last. We believe that all the reforms, with all the movement going back to Nigeria, we believe it's a time for a new Nigeria. And come February and come next year, we believe that a lot of changes are going to take place. But we need the hands. As a diaspora who has lived in Nigeria for the past 28 years, we need people like you, smart. We need people like our friend who just wrote this from America. We need all the best brain. The best of the brain in every country is the human resources. We're going to mobilize these human resources back to Nigeria to make sure that we all join hands to craft policy that benefit the people.
All right. You can say something now. Introduce yourself and let the world know where you are calling from.
I was born in Kaduna. I grew up in Kaduna. I went to schools in Kaduna. I witnessed the coup in Kaduna and the pogrom on Biafra. At 12 years,
are you addressing me or him?
No, he's making a point. Just listen here.
I enlisted into the Biafra guerrilla regiment. Is that we cannot have federal police in Nigeria. general put somebody from Kazaure to go and be police commissioner in nowhere? Does he know where the bad guys, where they meet? People like we have here, LAPD, the Los Angeles Police Department, is made up of people who are Los Angeles natives, who live there. Even the governor of California cannot give instructions to Los Angeles police because American law is written just like Nigerian law. It's not hard to operate it. Our legislators have a gun to their head. There are certain proposals they cannot make, even when they know it.
But the same gun does not affect them when they are sharing and stealing our money.
No. Look at it this way. That began to have that took a life of its own when Nigeria adopted executive presidency. It limited the ability of the people to question their government. So what happens is that when the people who actually control the government, namely Fulani, when they steal to their food, they just look for, they leave the crumbs for those who will pick it up. And if it becomes necessary, if you become a troublemaker, they will investigate you somehow for stealing money. But look at it this way. No matter how we do it, except every community has its own police, not even under the government, every local government must have its own police that does not report to anybody other than the local government. When we had it, if there is a customs checkpoint in that town and the people steal money there, we are arrest them and prosecute them without nobody coming from Abuja or anybody coming from anywhere to plead the case or take the case and move it somewhere else. If there is an immigration office in your town, nobody there should sell passport booklets. If we catch you, we imprison you right there. Bad roads, no health care, all of this is as a result of gross corruption. And the two drivers of corruption in Nigeria is the Nigerian army and federal police, because they provide cover for the powers that be. We must change, unless we change that, Ken Peter Obi, or the best ruler of Nigeria, advised by Angel Gabriel, cannot change Nigeria.
You are right. You are right. Thank you. You still have some more to say?
Well, I always have a lot to say.
Okay, maybe I will book a date for you. You know, because there was a time I sent you a message, but I'm not sure you got that message.
I got it, but I got it late.
Okay.
You have been off the air and so on, and I responded to you on Messenger, but it never went through.
Okay. Okay, so what? Go ahead.
What I'm saying now is this: anybody can claim anything they want to about Hausa. I actually sat in the meetings of the Kaduna Mafia. I know the address, the house, the time, everything about it.
Hmm.
And I speak Yoruba because I went to high school at Aquinas College, Akure. I'm a full Nigerian.
Wow.
But I am more of Hausa because my mother has a stall. She had a stall at the Kaduna Railway Station.
Yes.
Which, before 1967, it is the airport, the railway station, and the stadium, and Murtala Mohammed Square. Those were the only places.
Wow.
Nothing else.
Wow. Wow. So when was the last time you went to Kaduna?
Has up to 2 inches of crude oil flowing in it in the Delta. industrial riverine property. There are land, arable land, that has almost 6 inches of caked crude oil on it that you can never farm on again for 200 years. What happens is that the sun eats those hydrocarbons and they go up in the air. When they go up in the air, they are tangible materials. What happens is that westerly winds blow them, and when they get into the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, they get a life of their own, and then they make landfall on the eastern United States. All of this started about 25 years ago when this bad government, really seriously bad government, came into place. If the U.S. government does not go to resolve the climate change, the environmental degradation of the Nigeria's Delta, they will be paying, because Al Gore said it in 2018 in a Van Jones CNN show that hurricanes alone cost the United States $320 billion in 2017. And that's, you're not talking about landslides. You're not talking about the type of wildfires that burn out entire cities in California. So, if the United States government does not go to Nigeria because we are directly opposite to them, if it's happening in Lagos, it's happening in New York in 8 hours. If they don't go to Nigeria, if they continue to toe the British line of saying, hands off, this is our sphere of influence, the United States is in for a big problem. I have wasted all my money and had people con me just fighting climate change in the Delta, even though I'm from Imo State.
Well, you made mention of one thing. You said a Sunni Muslim. Is this about Sunni Muslim or about some Nigerians who are nasty? You know, I think.
No.
Yes. I agree with you. In recent times, I've seen the army has been destroyed. There's no question about that. And
with their guns, they will not allow people petition the government. You can't petition the government. You can't say, like we have it in the United States, you make a proposition, if 300,000 people sign it, it goes into the election to change or improve something. In Nigeria, we can't improve anything. We can't say we don't want this anymore. This is what we want.
Okay, so what is your idea of the way forward? You know, because we cannot continue to be stuck in this lockdown.
Two things. You do two things. Within a few years, Nigeria will improve. Everybody will become accountable. First of all, we must restrict the role of the military. We must defang it. The military cannot be stronger than the police on our streets. Every community must have its own police, hired and fired by them. And there can be one clearing house, federal clearing house, so that local governments can put in their inventory of what they need for their police force.
Yeah.
But we can't have federal police and we can't have the Nigerian army enforcing law. That is why in America they say we the people, the community owns the police. LAPD reports to the people of Los Angeles. Houston Police Department reports to the people of Houston, to the mayor, not to the governor. We can't have the governor in charge of police, because then it is like, you know, exchanging one bad thing for another. Governors will take over the police and use it to still do the same nonsense that is happening.
Okay.
We're not supposed to reinvent the wheel. We're not supposed to reinvent the wheel. We should just do it how developed countries do it. We adopted American presidential system. We took all the benefits. Everybody has a media aid, and the media aid to the governor has its own media aid.
That's empowerment. That's their way of creating jobs. They create all those stupid jobs. And again, that is what is raining now. Every young Nigerian wants to be a PA or an SA. SA to what? You know. But Mr. Gumba, I'm gonna have a moment with you in no distant time, so we can talk a lot about everything. Because I've listened to a lot of your work. I've read so many of your work. And you are a person of interest to me that I would like to talk to. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. It's a pleasure. How is Los Angeles this afternoon?
Well, it's sunny and everywhere is good. We are happy that Morocco beat Portugal.
Wow! By what margin? Oh, great, great. So we have one more African team left in the race.
Yes.
Maybe this time they will get it. All right, good to hear from you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
All right, you take care. Yeah, that was Charles Ogumba. He's a hot man that I would like to talk to, you know. So welcome back, Brother Gbandi. You know, you see, Nigeria has a barrage of problems. And there's some people, especially those who live in it, they don't understand. I look at Nigeria as a soccer ball. You know, you see all the patches around it, but the people inside don't even see it. They have become so accustomed to it. They have resigned that there's nothing they can do. You know, can you hear a Nigerian saying that this has been like this, nothing can do it, and they resign to God and say, only God can save Nigeria. How will only God, after God gave you dominion, and you are still coming him to asking him to come down and save Nigeria? That's stupid. But unfortunately, that is a statement of resignation, you know, typical of a people who are round and round repressed. Now, it's a lot. I don't even know, you know, it's a lot. But we have to talk. I'm going to have to invite you some more time, you know, so we can talk some more. And people hear you exactly, you know, the ideas that you have. Because the problem that we have in Nigeria is a big problem of huge ignorance, which most of us don't accept. We get very offended when you tell them. When you tell somebody you are ignorant, you say you are insulting him. You are ignorant. You can tell me I'm ignorant when I lack knowledge in a particular thing. I don't get offended by that. But Nigeria, that is an offense. Every little thing is an offense. All right. Now, good. Healthcare. You come from a country where healthcare is at a top notch. And then you come from a country where you were born, where you go into the hospital, you begin to wonder. Even that your cat in Germany won't allow it to be treated in that hospital. What legislation are you going to introduce? Now, this is a moment of question on legislation, because that is what you are going to do there. But unfortunately, in Nigeria, you know, people will tell you, I want to go. Senator will come and say, you want to build a hospital. How are you going to build a hospital as a senator? All right. So what legislation are you going to bring to revolutionize healthcare in Nigeria from this? Really, I don't even want to say the colonial healthcare delivery system that is not even acceptable to cats anymore, that we continue to do. And you see, for like our state, Delta State, the governor he says a medical doctor, but I question that. If he's a medical doctor and the state healthcare institutions, 64 of them, you know how many nurses do they have? 1,002 nurses. Are the ones driving healthcare delivery in Delta, the whole of Delta State, the healthcare delivery system. 1,002 nurses, 64 hospitals and healthcare centers, 1,002 underpaid and overworked nurses are there. Then this state has over 5,000 SAs and SSAs. My brother, what will you do to bring about, to inspire a new thinking in healthcare?
Let me start by saying that I realize the importance of healthcare because they say health is wealth. That is why even before the first vote is cast, even before I'm elected as a senator to represent the good people of Delta North, I've been running medical missions for the past 2 years.
where I come with my German medical friends to deliver, you know, basic, you know, primary health, you know, care system. But of course, we're not going to run a system where we outsource our medical cares, you know, to diaspora outreach program. We're only trying to do a complementary services. But the most important thing is that you have, you know, you have stated the statistics, and statistics figures don't lie. You can imagine that when we have a state governor that have more SSAs than the number of nurses we have in a government hospital, I mean, it's obvious what to expect. It's obvious that our state is not, they are not putting priorities on the health of Nigerians. They have other consideration as their priorities. You know, let even without even going into rocket science, saying that you have this number of hospitals in Nigeria, and you have totally an understaffed hospital, the first thing and probably we need to do is to to pass a legislation that is going to mandate a number of people to a certain number of doctors, so to say, compelling the state, you know, to have a certain number of personnel in a certain number of hospital, you know, to be able to, you know, to attend to, you know, to the health situation of the country. But secondly, you know, doing that is also to encourage the private sector, you know, to invest into the healthcare sector. You encourage the private sector by making an investment in the health sector very, very uncomplicated, you know, with also other incentives. So I believe that if we could look at, you know, the legislative aspect of that governing healthcare system, seeing exactly where we can, you know, we can mandate, in terms of their hospitals and doctors. But normally, to cap it up, we should have a healthcare system in Nigeria that, you know, mandates, workers, you know, to have a certain, payment into a common post where they can access the healthcare system as long as they are government workers. Probably they have something like that. But the question is that are they effective? I don't know if they are effective. That's one. And secondly, we should also be able to encourage both from academic, from tertiary institution, you know, to give some incentives about people who are, you know, getting into medical sectors when they graduate, what kind of incentives we are going to give them. And so when we look at that comprehensively, and we should be able to, you know, to look at how we can improve our healthcare system, because the number of population in Nigeria is exploding. We say we are about 200 million, but, you know, statistics say that we are over 200 million, 250 million. And when you regress regress the number of the population we have to the number of health institutions we have, you see that we are definitely not doing justice to the health system. So we are going to have a situation where we're going to look at the issue of having more healthcare system, institution of healthcare systems across the federation, institution of having also encouraging private healthcare to get into a healthcare system, while looking at the ability to pay people who are actually also working in the healthcare system. So we probably have excess of minimum wages across board, especially in the medical sectors, can also look at as in terms of legislative approach. But having said all that, it's important that even the very, very few hospitals we have are well equipped. It's important that more medical personnel will be encouraged to take up a practice in the medical healthcare rather than outsourcing them. I mean, it's very, very unfortunate where our doctors, our health minister is saying that people can travel abroad if they want to, that will have enough doctors in Nigeria. You know, such statement, even though it's not a policy statement, is totally not encouraging to our healthcare system. Again, I think Nigeria needs a holistic reforms across board. Nigeria needs good heads, you know, who are good in these areas to come together to look at what we have and comprehensively look at where we need to, you know, to make unnecessary reforms. That's exactly what I was encouraging my compatriot also in the Senate to look into and join me in that direction.
Thank you. Listeners, viewers from within Nigeria and around the world, we've been talking with you've been listening to this conversation very burning conversation about the future, the present and future of Nigeria, with Kenneth Gbandi, Delta North senatorial candidate on the platform of ADC. We have talked about a lot of issues that are facing the country at the moment, requiring people with the type of intellect and the ability to sacrifice to make things happen for all of us. If anybody has any question, those you know who may have questions, you call the number to call is +1 832 407 6282. We have been on this for quite nearly 2 hours. I think we'll be rounding up in a few minutes, you know, so that the busy senatorial candidate can go about looking for votes, you know, campaigning some more, and doing as much as he can in a very difficult time where the people of the country live below poverty line. So sad about the state of Nigeria right now. Now, one more thing that I would like to ask you a question about is corruption in Nigeria. It has reached a very dangerous crescendo, and I always describe it this way. Nearly everybody is involved and everybody is a victim of it. What do you think we can do to minimize, if not completely eradicate, this menace that young people grow into, and it's like sin as a culture? You have to do it. Even in the church, you see corruption. In the mosque, this is it. Not because some people want to do it. It's like a tradition. You are put into that realm of doing it, you know, unconsciously or by a degree of compulsion. I know what I go through each time I go to Nigeria, because I don't give bribe and I don't take. But it's always a difficult thing for me. And people, we now begin to see you as a problem. Give them back, we come out, you know, and stuff like that. Every Nigerian is in a hurry. That is where we are. So what can we do about this?
Professor Patrick Mulumba from, I think, Uganda, if I'm not mistaken, or Luanda. Yeah. Uganda. I think. He said that in China, when an officer is being, you know, court-martial for corruption, he commits suicide in Japan. In China, he probably will be shot dead. But in Nigeria, they will be given a chieftaincy title. So it just shows you the body language of the society of the people. And don't forget that a society deserves the leader the society get the leader they deserve. So I think we should begin to, you know, to examine our moral conscience in this country, to see that then when people begin to have fleets of cars, that we should begin to ask questions, you know, how did they make their wealth in the first place? That's number one. And number two is that we should also begin to, you know, we have systems that actually encourage corruption. What do I mean by that? If you get a police officer, as a matter of this is not my storyline. When I was the chairman of Nigerian Diaspora Organization in Europe, we have an MOU with ICPC, anti-corruption. And the idea was to join hands with them, you know, to fight corruption in Nigeria. The whistleblower is one aspect of that. We should be encouraged, as a matter of fact, even as a legislator, I think we should encourage that, you know, the whistleblower principle, for instance. But again, he was making up an idea that if you have a police officer who is, you know, meant to man probably an institution, and so that by 6 o'clock, this institution is closed and no other person is allowed to, you know, to get in there. You see, a police officer has not been paid salary for the past 3 months. He has a wife at home who is undergoing labor, and he has no money, you know, to treat the wife. That the temptation for this police officer to open up the gate for somebody who is going to give him 20 or 30 euro or 30 naira to, you know, to open up the gate, to make him to do something he doesn't want to do, is high. But if we have electronic gate, that all you need to do is you come to the gate, you slot in your card, the gate opens automatically, and we must begin to put, you know, processes in place that discourage corruption. But unfortunately, we seem to be encouraging processes that, you know, encourage corruption rather than, you know, decrease it. Of course, when you have also the issue of meritocracy and mediocracy, you want to employ people not based on merit, but because they sing, you know, your song for you. what you are basically doing is also corruption. Because knowing that you have washed this person's hand, that the person has to wash your hand at the end of the day. So at the end of the day, you see that Nigeria is running a corrupt society, so to say, or corrupt economy. And we need good leaders to begin to tackle these issues. We need a strong institutions like the ICPC, EFCC. They need to be encouraged. We need to bring people of integrity. Rubadu was a very good example. Barrister Ebonta was another good example, both of the ICPC and EFCC together. During their tenorship, we discovered that corruption was tackled, you know, head-on collision. So I see that while, you know, there are things that we can change through legislators, but also there are so many things we can change through strong institution and strong leadership. So appointing people with good credibility, institutional, you know, strengthening or stability can help a long way, you know, to curb corruption in Nigeria. So as a senator, we should be, you know, we should provide this institution all the necessary mechanisms they need to fight corruption. And we'll also make sure that whoever is being appointed to the institution go through a rigorous process to make sure that we bring the right people to the table. When we do a combination of this, we'll begin to eliminate corruption in Nigeria, if not totally eradicate it.
What about, do you think about the preemptive prevention from before it happens?
Well, like everything in the world, yes. I mean, they say prevention is better than cure, so to say. So I think education is good in the society. But like I said, you know, they say seek ye first the kingdom of God and other things shall be added onto that. In the other way, let us get a good leaders. Once we get good leaders, every other thing should be added onto that, because it's this good leader that will drive reforms. These good leaders that also will drive legislators that are going to bring in something about a good economy and good system. So let's begin to work hard to elect credible people come 2023. Once we get credible people online, I believe that every other thing should begin to fall in place.
Cool. It's been such a wonderful moment here with you. I think we're going to draw the curtain here. I would want you to talk to the people of Delta North. What do you expect? What you are about? What is this Gbandi? What are you going to do? In summary, you know, in education, in economy, local economy, healthcare, and all the things that makes you different from more to that place is in a dire need of this senatorial direction. We want to move away from the darkness that has crippled our people. It crippled them mentally. It crippled them physically. It made them all round and round poor.
Well, the simple story that we can, if we begin to talk on healthcare, on job creation, on security, we can actually go till tomorrow morning, because we have a lot of things to offer. But the important thing, like I said, once we get leaders, good leaders, every other thing will follow. So Kenneth Gbandi is coming to Delta North with global leadership experience. Kenneth Gbandi is coming to Delta North to domesticate 28 years of international experience, both legislative and also leadership. And so once we get leaders, the leaders we can trust, things will begin to fall in place. Reforms, you know, youth capacity building, provision of jobs, you know, leveraging on our contact with the international investors to come and invest in Delta North. What is important is that we cannot keep doing the same thing all over again and have a different result. Look at the I believe it's a school that you're showing me. Look at the dilapidation of such a school. Look at such a horrible building that we have. What else we have over how many thousands SAs to the governor? Why we don't have enough money to pay teachers and retirees? So these are the issues that it's about leadership. So I'm coming with a global leadership experience. I'm coming with a fresh political breath. I'm coming without any excess luggage tied to godfathers, tied to, you know, very few. I'm coming as an independent-minded, diaspora-exposed, experienced leadership to Delta North. And together, I think we can begin to address the issues of reforms, representing Delta North in the Red Chamber, begin to join my colleagues in the Red Chamber to push for things that will bring this country forward. So my appeal to people of Delta North, they have tried other political parties. They have tried them for the past 20 years. Nobody can beat his chest or her chest and say, we are where we want to be. So let's try something new. Let's try a fresh political bread, somebody with a leadership, international leadership experience. So we're going to vote for credible candidates to make sure that we begin to enjoy the dividends of the democracy like we have across the globe. So on February, we are asking Nigerians, especially Delta Northerners, to come and vote for credible candidates and forget about party. They should not sell their vote. They should vote for people who they think that are going to come and make life better for them. That's my appeal to people of Delta North.
Thank you. Thank you. There's one more question that just cropped up now. I hope that nothing else will crop up for now. Let's draw the curtain. But diaspora. We are the reason the Nigeria still has an economy, because Nigeria's economy is bankrupt. $30 billion every year. It's a lot. But yet, the diaspora is relegated to the background. They can't vote. They can't register to vote where they reside. For the few of us who register, we have to travel. I know how much it cost me to travel to come and register to have a PVC in our hands so we can make that change. What will you do to end this procrastination? Because Jonathan Goodluck, that's why I fell out with him personally. He came to Houston, he lied to us that the diaspora were going to vote in the 2011-2015 election. That those two election cycles came and went, and he didn't do it. He made a pronouncement in the presence of world leaders in Canada about diaspora voting. He came and went. We never had the opportunity of registering. And then they know the number of the Nigerian diaspora can cancel out all the fraud that they commit in electoral and Nigerian elections. So some people are scared. So what will you do to get
this? My interest is that as the chairman of Nigerian Diaspora Organization, we led a delegation that actually pushed for this electronic voting that we have in Nigeria today. As a matter of fact, what we are pushing was diaspora voting. And INEC, in a closed-door meeting, agreed that they can actually conduct the diaspora voting, but they need two things. They need to have an amendment of the Constitution to have electronic voting, because electronic voting is a prelude to diaspora voting. So we with our competitors in Nigeria, we initiated the issue of the diaspora voting. Unfortunately, during the committee section, they removed the diaspora voting and only passed the electronic voting. So the fact is that we have started that initiative. As a senator representing the Delta North, I'm also representing the diaspora as a constituency. And I promise that based on our diaspora network, based on our legislative experience, diaspora voting is a thing that must come in the next 2-3 years if we elected, because we know how to lobby, we know how to mobilize the diaspora based on our own experiences, and we also know how to mobilize the legislators. So I can tell you that if elected the senator representing the Delta North, but I'm also going to represent the diaspora, and we're going to mobilize the diaspora, join with the experiences we have to mobilize also our compatriots in Nigeria to make sure that the diaspora voting is going to be a reality before the next 2-3 years.
Thank you. Thank you. So with this, we come to a close of this, and looking forward to having you on our show again. Thank you for the time.
Thank you so much.
I know what it is that you are dealing with in that place, and I know how much time you need to do, but safety wise, security, please. I've been through it. I escaped 4 kidnap attempts. This is not a joke. In Delta North, in fact, the last one at Obiaruku nearly turned bad. So be careful of how you travel. If you can avoid it, don't go any travel at night. Any person invite you for a night meeting, say no. Yeah, we can hold this meeting. We can talk over the phone, or we can hold it in the daytime. Once it's 6 o'clock, cut it off. No matter the pressure. No, if they lie, let them tell you that that is where you are going to get the vote. Most of the time, it's a lie, because I went through it. So God being on your side, and some of us will be calling you to let you know that, you know, here, there, and whatever we can do to support. For me, I am using this medium and this opportunity to personally endorse you. ONN is behind your aspiration. You can share support. And then
thank you
we
so
are
much.
Going to talk for you. We are going to do whatever we can to support you, to win. We take your message to all corners of Delta North and beyond. So whatever we can do to help you win, we are going to do it. Because you deserve to win. You are actually the only person in the race, as far as I'm concerned. You know, but along the line, you will hear some more. I will tell you things about all those people who are running, you know, contesting against you with lies. They have nothing to offer. It's the same thing. If you elect the other person, it's going to be a worse Nwaoboshi. It's the same thing that is driving them. So I know them very well. So I wish you the very best of luck. And always, please, security. It's very important. Very, very important.
And
be as true to yourself as possible. That's just, you don't have to impress anyone. Because they will come last minute trying to, they will create businesses around you if they are not already doing that, you know, to extort you. And the part of the strategy is to weaken you financially on behalf of your opponent. So they will send rakes. If you know, when during the war, they send little kids to find out intelligence information. You will see a lot of those wolves around you. Be very careful, note them. And then be nice, be friendly, but don't be a fool. So that's what I can tell you, my brother. I wish you the very best of luck. Yeah.
Thank
so God much. Bless you as you race, God and we'll be dealing. Take
Thank
care, my
so
brother.
Much. Thank All you right. so much.
Yes.
Bye.
Bye now. So, fellow Nigerians, it's been 2 hours 12 minutes with Gbandi Kenneth, the senatorial candidate for Delta North on the platform of ADC. We've grown past this party business that he has to be from your party. If he has to be from your party, well, 24 years of you voting for your party has demonstrated that that is a lie. What we are looking for is the character, the person who can do the job, regardless of what party he belongs to. Because at the end of the day, whatever party he comes from, he's going to represent all of us. We should not see people anymore as enemies because we have political variances. They don't belong to our political party. It could be that person who will save your son's life, if not you. It could be that person with the acumen that is required to take your environment to that high pedestal that will make the world know it. So if you stand in the way because of blind political allegiance, you know, you are on your own. And then there are consequences for bad behaviors like that. Behaviors related by bad choices. That is why our hospitals are dilapidated. That's why we have the worst of infrastructure in the whole of the world. That is why we have beasts leading us. That is why our educational system can be closed down and nobody is held accountable. 1 year, sometimes going to 2 years, universities are closed down. Those who are responsible for the closures have ferried their children outside where schools are open 24 hours. You can graduate in 2 years, you know, for a 4-year degree program if you're a hard worker. Yeah, yes, I'm telling you. So people have done it and they are still doing it. So we want a set of leadership that can keep our schools open every day without any more strikes. We want a set of leadership that can keep our hospitals working and working better every time. It's just a new leadership that is research oriented, that can sponsor, that can fund research, that can find ways to bring money together to fund researches, you know, that will better our education, better our healthcare, better our infrastructure, better our economy and the, you know, as a whole. So it's all about quality. And that is why we bring you the message of Open Nigeria. If Nigeria is open, the best will come out and take the lead. It doesn't matter from what they come with the heart of service and love for country. You see capacity builders, capacity utilizers, capacity expanders, capacity sustainers. You understand? and everybody will be happy. We need that sort of leadership that can craft a new social welfare policy that will translate into social security for the people of Nigeria. We don't have it. When any little thing happens, everybody is to your tent, O Israel. But here, listen, I'm telling you, when during COVID-19, I received over $10,000 from the U.S. government. I did not apply for it. I didn't stand in the line to lobby anybody for it. I didn't bribe anybody. I didn't even ask. They sent the check in tranches. Yes, this is not a joke. I think I will look for that video. I'm going to share it again. Yes, all Nigerians who live here, who are residing here legitimately, even those who are residing here illegitimately, at least had food to eat during COVID-19. In fact, they are still distributing food. Yeah, you go to some centers, you go and collect and go and eat. Me, I don't eat American food. So when they give me, I'll go give them to people. You understand? So that is just what it is. We want a country that will work for all of us. Not by religion. Because religion is not our problem. Poverty is the problem. And poverty of leadership. These poor leaders, they are the ones who stoke all this religious violence. And everybody's looking for God. Poor man is looking for God, to survive, to hopefully go through the next day. When God has given us everything that we need, we refuse to use the power that God gave to us in the right direction. That is why we are suffering. Now, you can't say that you have not been told anymore. You have seen the light, like Bob Marley said. Now we've seen the light. We got to stand up for our rights. So that is why. So if you are rich, you are poor, you are tall, you are short, you are a woman, you are a man, you are a boy, you are a girl, you are a child, you are an old person, it's time to stand up. Not just stand up, standing up. Stand up for your neighborhood. Stand up for your community. Stand up for your local government. Stand up for your state. Stand up for Nigeria. That is just what we are asking. God bless you all, and God bless Nigeria.
Fellow Nigerians, our country is going through one of its worst moments in history. The state of Nigeria requires all of us, regardless of where we are on earth, to come out of our comfort zones, to battle for our soul. Our country is under siege on all fronts. Our country has been taken over by janjaweeds that pretend to be leaders. The question is, how much can we take? How much more can we take? Here is a country where a citizen went into the hallowed chamber of the Senate and carted away the mace, the symbol of authority of the National Assembly, and was not punished. What type of example is that? Here is a country where the government allegedly spent $600 billion feeding students at home, students who were on lockdown, and nobody is raising a finger. How on earth do we have a country that cannot cater to its youth?